Loredana Quadro left Italy 19 years ago to pursue a career in science here in the U.S.
The United States were always seen as the place to be a scientist because there were lots of opportunities.
So was it your dream to, you know, one day have your own lab?
Of course, of course.
Quadro has now been running her own lab at Rutgers University in New Jersey for almost 10 years, and she's built her career on answering a very specific question: how vitamin A is absorbed by embryos. And understanding that basic function could ultimately help prevent birth defects.
When you actually understand or think you might have understood a little tiny thing that is going on into a cell, it's really rewarding.
But now, all her years of work is in jeopardy. Like many scientists working at a university, she depends on grants from the federal government to run her lab. They pay for everything, from supplies to her team of researchers. If Quadro doesn't get a new grant by July, she'll be out of money.
So you're in danger of losing your lab?
Yes.
The National Institutes of Health, the NIH, is the single largest funder of biomedical research in the world. But over the last 13 years, the NIH budget has actually declined more than 22% in terms of purchasing power. And tighter budgets have meant that getting one of those coveted grants is even more difficult. In the past, a third of all grants submitted were funded. Today, it's about a sixth of all grants. And many say this hyper-competitive atmosphere is threatening not only the careers of promising scientists, but the advancement of scientific breakthroughs.
It's a very stressful.
Quadro says that she's constantly worrying about money. She estimates that she spends about 80% of her time working on grants.
How does having to focus on grant writing, how has that affected your work in the lab?
I don't work in the lab. I can't, because I have to work on grant writing the most of the time.
People who could be doing experiments are instead writing, rewriting, submitting, resubmitting, trying to get that grant. And what a terrible waste of talent.
Dr. Francis Collins is the director of the NIH and has been pushing for more research funding.
Whether it's in cancer or Alzheimer's disease, basic science, clinical applications, we're at a remarkable moment scientifically, but paradoxically, we're at about the worst moment we've been to support that, at least in this country.
One would think that when you're in an environment that's this competitive for dollars, that only the best of the best science is going to get funded.
Turns out that's not true, because we can look back now. Can we actually say that the top sixth was better than the next sixth? Turns out we can't. You can't tell them apart. So what does that say? That says we're leaving half of the great science on the table that's coming to us now, because we can't find the funds for it.
Dr. Collins recently testified before a House Appropriations Committee asking for a 3% increase to the NIH's budget, enough money for 1,200 new grants. But Subcommittee Chairman Tom Cole warned that while everyone supported biomedical research, a big increase to the NIH budget was not likely.
Given the reality of funding allocations, we might not be able to do everything that the administration is proposing.
Science is not a 100-yard dash. It's a marathon. And what that means is that the science we're not doing today, because we don't have the resources, is hurting our future 10, 15, 20 years from now in ways that we don't even know.
Why should it be, you know, the government's responsibility to be the primary funder for biomedical research? Why not foundations or private industry?
Private industry, frankly, is not going to do that. Their stockholders are expecting a return on that investment, and increasingly expecting that return to happen quickly in a matter of a couple of years.
And Dr. Collins says that philanthropy funds only a tiny fraction of research compared to the NIH, and often has a narrow focus on specific diseases.
You know, he left academia because...
Judith Storch is a colleague of Loredana Quadro's at Rutgers. She's been a scientist for more than three decades and has seen the dramatic change in the competition for science funding over the years. Although it hasn't been easy, she's been consistently funded during her career. She says having years of experience can give senior scientists like her a leg up.
Part of the reason I think it's easier for a senior investigator to get funded than a junior investigator. It's because we have a track record.
And some in the next generation have decided to drop out altogether.
We have graduate students that decide not to finish. We have graduate students who finish and then go and do something entirely different. But people are opting out like crazy.
Including Leslie Wasif-Barasik. She was Quadro's first postdoctoral fellow and came to the U.S. from Australia in 2006. But after 7.5 years in Quadro's lab, she decided to switch careers. She's now working as a medical writer.
I mean, that's a big decision to change course like that.
Yeah, it was a tough decision. I thought I could do it, but I was very naive. I didn't see how hard it was to get a grant. And no matter who you spoke to, no matter which lab you spoke to, everyone would say it was tough.
What wakes me up at night is this next generation and what's happening to them. They're invariably excited about the science that they're doing, but invariably anxious about whether there's a future.
The environment for science funding has left some questioning whether the United States will remain the same worldwide leader in science research that attracted Loredana Quadro and so many others here. A recent survey in the U.S. by an association of scientists found that 18% were considering leaving the country to pursue their careers.
We are still the leader, but not by a lot. And I can't help but point to China in particular. In another 4 or 5 years, they will be spending more in absolute dollars than we are. And the consequences are already apparent. China filed more patents in biomedical research last year than the United States did.
I mean, if there is a biomedical breakthrough in China, won't I still, as a citizen here, benefit?
But it's the country that is in the lead that is going to have lots of the most immediate consequences. Research that goes on in the U.S. has the highest likelihood of influencing our medical care in the short run. It also is the country that's going to have the greatest economic benefit.
Collins points to the Human Genome Project, which he led before becoming director of the NIH. A study estimated that each dollar invested led to $178 in economic benefit for the U.S., including jobs, tax revenues, and additional funding for genome research. To help scientists with funding, the NIH is experimenting with different models of funding, grants specifically geared towards younger scientists, and allowing investigators to resubmit grants multiple times. But for Loredana Quadro, time is running out. She's received some bridge funding from her university and continues to work on grants, including to the NIH.
Would you ever consider leaving the field?
It's a very difficult question. You know, if somebody doesn't get funded for 5 years, you are automatically out of the picture. It will be very tough to go back in. And if this happens, I will have to make a decision.